Hi everyone, welcome to Peoples Online. Our goal is to encourage and inspire you on your walk with God. Come and join us on Sunday mornings at 9:30 and 11:15. Stay tuned for the whole video and we'll be able to give you ways to connect with us. Enjoy today's message.
Today, I just really want to chat. This is week 20 of the Believe series. Week 20. Just give yourself a hand, all right? We are at week 20. That's crazy. And I've never been at a church that's done a series this long, and we've never done a series. I think the longest ones we've done might have been 6 or 8 weeks, and we're at week 20. That actually is only two-thirds of the way. There's another 10 weeks that we're going to do after Easter, and those are going to be amazing as well. Today, I just want to wrap up sort of we've been doing these things that what should we do as followers of Christ? And, you know, we've talked about things like worship. We've talked about things like prayer. We've talked about being a biblical community. We've talked about, you know, that we're spiritually gifted. We've talked about just all these amazing ideas. Even last week, giving your resources. And so we've been talking about all these things that what followers of Jesus should do. And so really, I don't think this 10 weeks are everything, but you know, we've really hit most of the major ones. And today, we're going to be talking about sharing your faith. Somebody's like, boom, 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 boom. All right? We're going to talk about this. Now, listen, it is said that more people fear public communication more than death. Now, I find that amusing, okay? I am not, like, listen, I get nervous, and I don't always love being up in front of people, but I would rather do some public speaking than die, okay? No matter how bad I do, all right? Like, you just don't die over that. Say something publicly, all right? But tying these things together, just realize that, you know, some of us, we got a great fear to just even talk publicly. Whether we're sharing with a couple of people or sharing with many people, however that looks. And then we tie in this idea of like, hey, all of us that are followers of Jesus should be out sharing your faith. And all of a sudden, you know, I clamp up. I've got a knot in my stomach. I'm afraid. I'm worried because, you know, it's like tying together a whole bunch of things that, you know, we wish didn't make us uncomfortable or didn't intimidate us, didn't make us afraid, but we know that they do. Has anyone else here been a little bit afraid to share your faith? Like, it's all right. There's no, you know, okay, there's 5 people that are honest in here. Okay, I'll put up both hands so you'll be comfortable, all right? Come on. How many of you been afraid? You've had moments where you're like, should I now? I'm scared to do that. And especially if we feel like we're a bit on the offensive, okay? Like, there's times that, you know what, yes, natural conversations come up with the people that are around us, and the majority of us, you know, we're good with that, right? If it comes our way, we'll ante up, hopefully. Okay, we're going to talk a little bit more about that because maybe you don't even feel that way. But you know what? Just being actual promoters of the gospel of Jesus sometimes, you know, is a daunting task. And all of us, I don't care whether you feel this is your gifted area, that you feel like, you know, you have the heart of an evangelist, you have the giftings of an evangelist, or whether, you know what, you just feel pretty introverted and you're just like, man, sharing my faith just scares me and it's a struggle for me. No matter where we land, there's going to be things for us to learn this morning because all of us as followers of Jesus should be sharing our faith. Now, sometimes we don't realize that when we don't share our faith or we've sort of lost ourselves in just our thinking that we don't know that sharing our faith is actually part of the fulfillment of God's purposes on the earth. It's not just a good thing to do or it's not just a mandate we made up as we went along as the church. It's actually straight in Scripture and God relates this idea and this is how he actually decided to work through the church. I'm going to get back to that in a couple minutes. So this key idea is that I need to share my faith with others to fulfill God's purposes. That adds some more weight to it in my mind. It's not just so that I can say I have a testimony or that I do some good deeds or I do a good work and share my faith. No, it's actually, we need to realize that when we share our faith, that we are fulfilling part of God's purpose on the earth. That puts more weight on it. So this is what followers of Jesus do. And why do they do it? Well, because hurting and lost people matter to God. Now, just quickly, I want to ask you some questions. So, do you believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life? Okay. I'm glad you got that one right. Okay. This hasn't been all for naught. All right? It's been good. All right. Now, here, do you believe that Jesus is the only way? Okay. This is significant. Okay. Because that statement right there is a dividing line, of dividing lines in the area of God, okay? Because lots of people believe in higher power, believe in God or a God, whatever that may look like or sense or feel like to them. But there is something very distinctive about us as followers of Christ that we believe that Jesus is the only way. Now, this isn't trying to insult anybody else or insult other people's religions. It's just that we don't believe that their way is a way. Okay? And I know that it's just like, well, that's just not politically correct, Pastor Tony. We're going to have to take that up with Jesus because he is the one that said that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father except through him. So our issue is not just with Christ's followers. Our issues are actually with the words of Jesus and the spoken things that he has said. So we believe that Jesus is the only way. Now, here's another thing that I want to ask you. Do you believe that there is unlimited room available for anyone who believes? You know, Jesus didn't just die for those that are going to believe. He died for everybody. This is something that we want that to get right into our theology. Because there's some that believe that he only died for those that are being saved. It's like, no. Christ so loved the world that he gave. You know, that he's the Son who came. That God so loved the world that he sent his Son. And that he would lay down his life. He loves the entire world. Everybody. And there's unlimited room available for anyone who believes. There's lots of room still on this boat or on this bus, as it were. And so we should be passionate about telling people about Jesus. That is good news. There's room for everyone. There's room for anyone who will call upon the name of the Lord. Now, if you're here today and you're a follower of Jesus, somebody told you. Somebody told you about Jesus. Now, that might have been your parents. That could have maybe been an aunt or an uncle, a relative. That could have been a pastor. But that, you know, more than likely, that was probably a friend. That was a neighbor. That was maybe a coworker, a classmate. That was someone who showed up in your life and they told you about Jesus. And aren't you eternally grateful that somebody stepped out and told you about Jesus? Yes. I'm eternally grateful. I was a hard case. I needed to be told about Jesus a lot. Like, it just didn't sink in at first. Were any of you, none of you find that surprising? Like, seriously, like, I am just so indebted that along the way that people, you know, humbly shared the gospel with me again and again. I know it started with my parents, but it wasn't just my parents, actually. It was people of the church. It was people that loved God, that, you know, through their testimony and through their example, that I saw real life, living people that were walking this out. And from what I saw in them, I began and embarked on my own relationship with God. Someone told me, and that's why I'm here today. And so the same is for all of us. If you're a follower of Jesus, someone told you. And so we need, it would be wrong of us, you know, to take that light and hide it under a bushel or hide it under a bowl. No, we put it on its stand so that it gives light to everyone in the house. And so that other people will see and know God. They will hear about the works of God and what God does in the heart and in the life. And you know, this needs to be flowing and operating out of us because somebody did it for us. We definitely need to do it for others. This needs to get inside of our hearts, inside of our vision. So doing the same. But you know what? It's simple, but it's not that simple. So now, I just want to relate a couple simple ideas, though, here. Is that God never meant the church to just be about Sunday services. There are statistics that say that the average Christian has no unbelieving friends after 3 years. So as you become a follower of Jesus and you sort of, you know, you get inside the cocoon of church, and over time, all of a sudden, you begin to realize that you don't know anyone anymore that doesn't know Jesus. Now, I think there's a whole lot of reasons. Obviously, you know, sometimes people around us don't live the same lifestyle, and maybe, you know, there's a collision there. There's some offense there, or whatever. But listen, all of us need to know people that don't know the Lord. We need to be interested in people that don't know the Lord. We need to care about people that don't know the Lord. We need to welcome them into our lives, into our homes. Love people, care about people. This is how we actually share our faith. It's not just about standing on a street corner and yelling out that everybody's going to hell if they don't repent. Okay? That is truth, but truth needs to be given with grace. Okay? These things need to be tied together. And you know, like sometimes we can't handle the truth, okay? And that's not just in A Few Good Men, all right? That movie, all right? But it's the truth. Is that we cannot handle it all at once, and we need people around us that bring the truth in grace, wrapped up in love. It's not just nice ideas, it's the truth, and it's how we need to share our faith. You see, God never wanted the church to be inwardly focused. God doesn't just desire us just to come to church. I know that church is good. I work at a church. I love the church. I believe in the church. But the church needs to be focused outward. We need to care about people around us. It was interesting, this was years ago, but Rick Warren was preparing and he was doing a whole bunch of studies to write that book, The Purpose-Driven Church. And it was interesting, in their studies, he found this, that 89% of the church believe it is for them. It's about my needs and my family. And that only 11% of the church believed it was about reaching the lost. This is out of balance, okay? It's about both of these things. We know that, okay? It is about both of these things. And I'm not trying to, listen, Rick Warren's quote is not gospel. I'm going to read you another thing from George Barna. And this is from his book about evangelism works. And it's just interesting. This is just his findings, okay? Just, I don't want anyone to choke on this, but this is just what he has found through the surveys and the polling that the Barna Group has done. So he wrote a book called Evangelism Works, and he basically said this, that most churches only have a small group of people who are passionate about reaching out, about evangelism, about winning the lost. And so he asked these three questions, and I want to ask these three questions of us today. In his book, he asks this, basically, number one, do people own evangelism as a heartbeat of the ministry of the church? It's just an interesting question to ask. Number two, is evangelism deemed the highest priority of the church? He asks another question. Number three, have the people of your church caught the vision for reaching non-believers that gives the church definition, energy, and direction? So he's coming with this idea and he's saying, wait a second, reaching the lost should actually be part of the fuel that defines us as a body, that helps give us direction as a body, that helps us, you know, have purpose together. It should be about winning the lost. And so this is Barna's conclusion. If these are not priorities, and notice how he chooses his words. He says, if these are not priorities for your organization, it is not really a church, but a group of people who are intrigued by religion. I was like, I read that and I was like, ouch. If we as the church forget that we have to be caught up in and realize with the message that we need to get the word out, that our world is lost without Jesus, that our world needs the message of Jesus, that we as a church, this has to be a priority. This has to be one of our main things. I know it's not the only thing, but it definitely has to be one of our main things. And so this doesn't just start at the whole top level, you know, on the macro level. This also has to start on the micro level, and that each one of us as individuals, a big part of our life needs to be as a follower of Jesus, that we would be desiring to share our faith with people that don't know Jesus, that it would be a big part of our life. Otherwise, we may be just intrigued about religion. And I don't think that that's where we want to be, or we would, you know, even testify about ourselves. But it's a refining point, and we need to learn today. And I want us to just grab a hold of this again, that we need to be sharing our faith. These are good things. So, as I said, let's be honest. Sharing your faith is scary. It's not easy. If you want to, you can either take your Bible with me right now and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Maybe you have it on your phone, whatever. However you get into God's Word, can you go there with me? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I want to just relate a number of passages of Scripture. So number one is this. If I can just relate this simple thought to you today. God calls us to share our faith. This, as I said earlier, this isn't just, you know, a human-made mandate. This is the mandate of God. So this is what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14, okay? It says, "For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again." Now, I just want to just unpack this for a little bit, okay? Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all. You got to understand something, the context of what Paul is talking about here. This scripture is being written in the context of that the Jewish, the Israel people are the chosen ones and everyone else came second, right? Okay, there was a context, okay? And Paul, there's a great, like, conflict that's actually happening between, you know, that there's these Gentiles, basically people outside of the Jewish race and the Jewish religion that are coming to Jesus. And Paul is making this declaration, and he's saying that we are convinced that one died for all. There's no separation. Christ died for all, and therefore all died, you know, to the old life and in Christ, and he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, not just the Jewish people, but everyone, the Gentiles. We wouldn't live for ourselves, but we would live for him who died for them and was raised again. So then it says this next verse that really I feel like I could just camp out for the rest of the time. We need to get this. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. So Paul's relating this idea. He's like, Christ's love compels us. Jesus has died for all of us. And if we're followers of Jesus, we need to die to this life and live for Christ. Okay? That's what he's saying. And then he makes this bold statement. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Does anyone here struggle from looking at people with a worldly point of view? Or is it only me? Like, this week, I was sharing this with the staff earlier, and I was just like, oh my goodness, this is so convicting, because I just realized how much of my life I'm just looking through a worldly lens. You know, the people that we see, the people that, you know, you just interact with, whether it's the local store, you're at the mall, you're getting groceries, wherever, you just think, just imagine Costco and you're in the busy line. You know, do you see anyone from a heavenly point of view? You're like, get out of the way. Which line is shorter? What do you mean? How long does it take you to mark the receipt? Get me out of here. Oh, this parking lot, it goes forever. That guy cut me off. Ugh. You know, it's the love of Christ all over it. Right? And you know, let's be honest. That's just the simple everyday stuff. Let's talk about when, let's say someone in your family doesn't appreciate you. Or, you know what I mean? Someone actually at work stepped on your head and climbed up the corporate ladder above you and, you know, knocked you down a couple notches. Let's talk about when actually real stuff actually happens. You know what I mean? Someone steals something from you. Somebody takes something from you. Like, and we're just like, oh, bless them, Lord. Like, come on. Right? And God actually tells us in his word that we're actually to love our enemies. Think about how countercultural that is right now. I was driving to here this morning, and there was a truck ahead of me from the States. Nice big truck, dualies in the back, and I was like, whoa, that's a nice truck. And then I noticed he had a Trump sticker. Ew. And I saw, make America great again. Right? I was like, that guy's taking his life into his own hands. Right? I pulled up, I literally did. I was like, I got to see who this guy, you know, and I pull up beside him. He's like, I'd say he's like 55, scruffy. He's got sunglasses on. It's not even sunny yet. You know what I'm saying? And I'm just like going, this is a guy. He knows what he's about. But I'm just saying this because look at our culture right now. We claim to live in tolerance, but you know what, like a Justin Trudeau. Come on. As followers of Jesus, a lot of us have a hate on for that guy. Do you know what I mean? He represents a whole bunch of stuff that we don't represent. God says we're to look at even our leaders, the people around us. And I'm just picking that example, but come on. Don't tell me, you know, even in Canada, you know, we look at people, and I know we're a multicultural society, but we still, there's still prejudice. There's still stuff that we look, well, we don't really know them. Their house smells a little bit different. They cook with different stuff. That's weird, right? You know, and you're like, and we don't really, anyways, I'm just saying, I'm not trying to bring us to our lowest denominator, but I'm just saying we live in an interesting time, a polarizing time, that it is totally okay to just speak with, you know, the most strong of words to anyone you disagree with. Like, say, call them down to the lowest, especially politically. We saw it all, especially in the U.S. We saw just like how much, and listen, this is not how followers of Jesus should live. Amen. I want you to hear me today. I'll go on record to say it. This is not how followers of Jesus should live. Come on. We need to be people that don't see others from a worldly point of view. We want our vision to be affected because Jesus' love compels us and has changed us. That is the base. This is actually why we would share our faith. This is the motivation of why we would share our faith. Christ loves the world. Christ loves people. Christ loves your neighbor that doesn't know him yet, your coworker that doesn't know him. He loves you that does know, but he loves them just as much. And we need to be taken up with the same perspective. We don't look at anyone from a worldly point of view. Though once we regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, They are a new creation. The old is gone. The new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ. And listen, this is where it transitions. And it says, and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And here it is. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. So when I say that God calls us to share our faith, here it is. He's laying this all out. He's saying, Jesus has done all this stuff. It should compel us. And we shouldn't look at those around us from a worldly point of view, but actually from an eternal and a heavenly and a supernatural point of view. That's the way that we should look at them. And then God is saying, can you believe it? He's chosen us. And he's saying, he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Some of us think, well, God's just sovereign and he'll do his stuff and I'll just live here privately in faith and occupy until he comes. And it's like, no, you're missing the point that God has called all of us to share our faith. He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors. As though God were making his appeal through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Our message is simple to those that are around us. Be reconciled to God. There's room for you. There's a God who loves you, and he has gone to the greatest lengths to save you and redeem you. This message needs to be spoken through our lives. And so we need to be people who love people around us, because that's the perspective that God has. When he's saying, don't regard them from a worldly point of view, regard them in the way that I see them. And so if I could just say just two things that I think will help us to share our faith, will motivate us, will move us, will help us. It's two simple things. Seeing people as God does, so in love. The other thing that I see in Scripture says that we do this by the Spirit of God. God tells us in his word, especially in Acts, he says that the Holy Spirit would come upon us and we would go and be bold witnesses. Often I'm afraid to share my faith. I need to be filled with the Spirit of God. I need to be a person who's in the Word of God, that's following the Word of God, that's jumping in, diving in, and I'm going to just hit that in a moment. But these two things, letting the love of God compel us and compel our vision, and being filled with the Spirit of God are the two things that will help us to share our faith. So, God wants to make an appeal to the lost through you. How do you do this? Can I just tell you this real simply? Sharing your faith is this simple. Sometimes we're like, well, what? I don't know everything. What if they ask me some theological question that I don't know? I'm not telling you not to try to get prepared, okay? But listen, there always can be lots of questions, and sometimes you're going to have to come back and study some more. Sometimes you're going to have to maybe ask another teacher. You're going to have to ask a pastor. You're going to ask someone, hey, how do I answer this question? I don't seem to be aware of this. But I want to tell you that you should start with something very simple. Sharing your faith is telling your God story. Yours. Don't tell them mine. Well, Pastor Tony, he was just a reprobate of the worst kind. And Jesus showed up and now he's not anymore. All true, but you don't need to tell people my story. You need to tell people your story. Okay? And it's as simple as this. Every time we baptize people, we shoot a little testimony. And this is basically what we tell them. Tell us a little bit about your life before Christ. Tell us what happened when you encountered and accepted Christ. And tell us what your life has been like after you've received Christ. Okay, did everyone catch that? Before, right, Christ? Meeting and encountering Christ and accepting him. And then what my life is after. You can take your story, put it, what was your life like before? So when you're sitting there and the opportunity comes to tell a coworker, to tell your family, or tell a friend, whatever it might be, to share your faith, simply, hey, this is what I know. This is how I used to live. This is how I used to think. And then all of a sudden, you know what, someone told me they were praying for me, and all of a sudden someone shared Jesus with me, and actually at first it offended me and bugged me, But I got thinking about it. And obviously they were praying for me because something started to happen. Stuff started to happen in my life. And I'm only repeating this because I've heard this story again and again. This happens in people's lives. And God started to show up and God started to say some stuff to me. And I've got to a point where I couldn't, you know, refuse and ignore anymore. And I accepted Jesus. And oh my goodness, I'm so glad I did, because this is what my life's been like since I made that decision. That's how simple it is to share your faith. Tell your God story. This is how we do it, as simple and as practical as I can be. Living your faith is the best way to share your faith. Okay? Now, when you grow, the church grows. Now, why would I say that? I'm going to just hit this. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. This is what it says about the early church. Okay? It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Okay, so this is what the early church was doing, okay? They devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles, okay? They had decided to be, part of a community of faith, a fellowship, okay? They devoted themselves to that. They devoted themselves to the breaking of bread. They ate together a whole lot. Come on, church. Potluck every Sunday. Let's have it. Right? All the way. Hallelujah. I am well formed. I am growing as the church is growing. Right? Come on. But listen, like, I don't think it was just talking they broke bread, they just had communion together, which they did. But when they even had communion, they did. They had meals, because Paul actually talks about that, about how the influential people were eating before the other people. Anyways, it was a little bit different, a little bit more complicated when you have multiple services and you have hundreds and hundreds of people. But the point was that this body was tied together as a community, as a fellowship, and that they were actually sitting around tables and eating and breaking bread and enjoying and talking about life together. And then it says this other thing. They were about prayer. Interesting. So, it says that this is what the early church was doing. Now, this is what happened because of it. It says, everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor. Listen, the favor of all people. So not just people inside of the faith, they were experiencing the favor of all people. And then it says this amazing statement, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. End of chapter. There's a picture here of what the church needs to be about. You and I need to be people that obviously dedicate ourselves, devote ourselves to obviously hearing the teaching of God's word, that we dedicate ourselves to a community of faith, right? That we dedicate ourselves to sharing our lives together, that we're going to break bread and live amongst each other, and we dedicate ourselves to a life that's in direct prayer and relationship with God. If we do those things, I believe that the Lord is going to add to our number daily who are being saved. Why? Because we're going to influence people. We're going to get amongst the people that we work with. Because we're being changed, we're going to go out and be change agents in our world. We're going to actually have the favor of all the people. You know, when the church does the work of God, I believe, you know what? And it's like, you know, we may not get accolades by the media, we may not get accolades by the government or whatever, but you know, often we do. But it's not all about that. The main part is that, you know, word of mouth, that I go out and live my life before God and before my neighbors. And you know what? Opportunities come where we can share our faith and live our life out. And as we're growing and growing in our testimony, growing in our knowledge of God, growing in our relationship with God, that we're going to be hearing God speaking to us and directing us to people that are around us. Because that's what happens when we grow in relationship, when we step into prayer, into new ways, when we live amongst each other, we see the needs, we see the issues that are around us, we become well-rounded, we become usable in the kingdom of God. And so these are good things. So I want to just remind us today, where do we start? Well, let's start with these things that are simple in God's word. Let's devote ourselves to good teaching. It doesn't just have to be me. I'm just saying, devote yourself to learning from God's word. Devote yourself to one another. You know what? Well, they're a little bit flawed. That bugs me. Not devote yourself. Imagine if every family broke up because someone was flawed. There'd be no families. We know that families are God's idea, God's plan. Same thing with the church. We're not good if we're, you know, divided. We need to love on one another. So, bring it to this last thing. In 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 8, I believe this scripture sums up just what I've been saying, and it will take me to the end. It says this. This was Paul writing this to the church in Thessalonica. He says, "We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well." Paul relates this mandate and this idea that we just don't share the gospel. These things are tied together. We share our lives. We share the gospel. And I just want to just say to you that, you know, let's start with the growing and the learning and the becoming as the church. But there will come moments when, you know, we'll be sharing our life, but we also will share the gospel. And this last point is that we would speak up about our faith when the time is right. In Romans chapter 10, verse 14, it says, "How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?" Now, preaching doesn't always, you know, sometimes we get afraid of that term. We think of preaching and we're like, I got to get up at church and preach. I got to go to work tomorrow, create a pulpit, and start to preach at everybody. No. I'm just talking about sharing your faith and telling people the truth of who Jesus is. And that is preaching, okay? Because we're standing, that's what preaching is. It's standing for the Word of God. It's proclaiming who Christ is. This is the heart of what preaching is. And so we want to share our life with people, but then in relationship, there will be moments to share our faith, that we will preach because people need to hear. There has to be moments in our life. You know what? I know it's become really, you know, preach the gospel and if necessary, use words. That's become an excuse now. That used to be one of those really cool statements, right? But now I feel like we've flipped to the other side and it's just like, just show people with your life. But, you know, there's moments that we actually got to open our mouth and speak life. We need to be people that are in prayer because maybe God will speak something to you that will just so unlock the heart of someone else. When you stand and you are ready, you've grown personally and you're ready to share your faith. So these ideas, these are what followers of Jesus do. So here we are, the week of Easter. This is an absolutely amazing Sunday. This coming Sunday is always an amazing time here for us as a church. It has been for years. This week, I was just looking back and I was realizing the first big Easter presentation I was part of here at People's Church was in 2003. So that's a lot of years ago, okay? And we on Easter have been, you know, just putting a great emphasis on presenting the gospel. That's what we've been doing right from the very beginning. A simple presentation of the gospel of Jesus, okay? Next Sunday is going to be no different. We've got some amazing testimonies that are going to be told in video from people of our own church, okay? There's going to be amazing singing. There's going to be just the choir, the band, all of these things. There's going to be times we're going to share some very distinct things about what happened with Jesus, his death, his resurrection. It's going to be awesome. Now, I want us as a church, because I realize Easter Sunday is the largest Sunday for us as far as attendance goes, okay? If history, you know, proves true, okay? But this week, is there someone that you can bring on Easter that they would hear the gospel? That is there someone that you can invite? Is there someone that, you know what, we've been sending even this week, maybe you've already got it, we've been sending out e-invites, okay? Feel free to forward that on, okay? It's not just, we're not just inviting you if you already come here to church, okay? You already know to come. We want you to forward that to people that are inside your circle of influence. We want you, you know what, if you can, if you're on Facebook or social media, can you help us promote what we're doing as a church? Can I ask you, I know this is going to sound like Ancient of Days, maybe pick up the phone and actually call someone and tell them you'll bring them to church, okay? Don't just text them, okay? That's good, okay? You know, I know for our younger people, they're like, what? I have to talk to someone? Dear Lord. Now you ask too much. I'll text them. Okay, fine. Okay? But this is going to sound really crazy. Maybe even go over to their house and see them face to face. Break all the boundaries off. You'll be like, this is what the people lived like before technology. This is what they did. You'll be able to grow up and tell your kids, that's what we used to do. In the 90s. However it is, though, okay? I'm excited, and you know what? I believe a big part of when I read in Scripture, there's a number of Scriptures actually that talk about, and numbers were added to them daily, okay? I believe that happens when the church becomes one functioning body working together. That's actually how we will win our world, okay? Yes, we do it individually, but we do it corporately, spurring one another on, okay? And so this is a week, we are about something as a church, all of us. If you call People's Church your home, be in unity with us and invite people to come to church, because we believe that this is going to be a day of salvation where people are going to come into personal relationship with Jesus, and it's going to be the beginning of their story. The after story is not even written yet, and we're going to get to be part of it. And this is what the church is about. And so I want to just tell you, you know what? Where are they? It's in here somewhere. There's beautiful cards like this, great explanation on the back. There's stuff for kids next Sunday. The whole nine yards. Take some of these. Invite some people to come to church. Bring them with you. Let's share our faith. Let's share what we know. This is part of being a follower of Jesus. Okay? Let's just say it together. Amen, amen. And amen. Amen. Okay, let me pray over you today. Lord, we just thank you for your word. God, we just thank you that your word is living and active. It's sharper than a double-edged sword. And God, I just pray, first of all, you would help each one of us to change our perspective, that we wouldn't see the people around us from a worldly point of view. God, help us see through your eyes. Help us to see with love. God, help us to see with concern and compassion. God, help us to do that. And so, Lord, I pray even right from the very beginning, that's a beginning point for each one of us. Lord, revolutionize how we see. God, let us see as you see. So I pray that over us today. God, I pray also we would realize that we are called and that you have purposed us to share our faith. And so, Lord, help us to be bold to share our story. And any opportunity that comes, God, if a window of opportunity opens up that we will step through, we will be bold and we will share our faith. And so, God, help us to just be prepared and equip us by your Spirit. And so can you just say with me, church, say, Holy Spirit, help me. Holy Spirit, make me bold. Holy Spirit, come upon me and fill me today. So Holy Spirit, we just invite you to do that in us. And so God, we just pray for this week. God, I pray for just divine appointments and opportunities to happen through us as a church at just a multiplication, an exponential way, God, that there are just going to be testimonies of God brought this person up. I thought about them in the night. I dreamt about witnessing to them. I thought about that person, or I realized the need that they had, whatever it might be, that God, that there will be just divine appointments this week, and that next Sunday is going to be a day of salvation in this house with just an influx of people into this place that don't know you. And so God, help us be a church that has a heart for the lost. Help us to be a church that God is praying and believing for people that don't know you, that we've not lost that fervor and that we are about that as a body. And so God, help us today to align ourselves together and be in unity of spirit about this. And God, we look forward to celebrating, God, your death, but also your resurrection this coming Sunday. So God, help us, I pray, this week, and I pray it in your name, Jesus. And everyone said, amen and amen. God bless you today. Have a wonderful Sunday, okay? Amen.
I hope you enjoyed today's video. We would love to hear your story and what God is doing in your life. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to email us, info@thepc.ca. We have something for everyone and everyone is welcome. Visit our website, thepc.ca, or like us on Facebook. Have a good day.